Hello, goddesses. How are you? And today is the lady who is, oh my God, you all know her. You all know everything about her, but still I'm taking the privilege of introducing her to you. And she's a goddess who continuously risen above all odds that you can think about, you know, seriously. Braving chest below paralysis for past 20 years, winner of 5 President of India Awards, 4 Limca World Records, 3 International Awards, 68 National and State Medals, 23 International Medals, Padma Shri, Khel Ratna, and Arjuna Awardee. Dr. Deepa Malik is India's first paraplegic women biker, swimmer, rallyist, and India's first ever female paraplegic medalist, enabling people with disabilities through her foundation, Wheeling Happiness, and supporting the government of India in its various outreach campaigns like Swachch Bharat, Beti Bachao, Beti Padhao, Accessible India, Jaago Graahak Jaago, Khelo India, Fit India, to name a few. Her impact on the International Paralympic Movement has earned her a recognition of Global Women of the Year 2019 by the International Paralympic Committee among the 176 member countries. In 2019, she donned the very important role of being the New Zealand Prime Minister's Fellow and representing 130 crores Indians for the bilateral relationship between New Zealand and India. This year, Dr. Deepa Malik has been elected as the President of Paralympic Committee of India. So this year, she cannot compete. But anyways, welcome to our show, ma'am. How are you?
Welcome and good morning. I'm good. I'm concerned right now, but I am good because we all know we are all going through the stay home and self-restriction and self-isolation in India. We are going to break corona and I'm wishing everybody good health. Please wash your hands, keep the precautions going. And why has this... otherwise all's well.
Great.
We are behaving ourselves.
Yes.
We are being responsible citizens and we are participating in collective action.
Wonderful.
And I'm proud to be part of it. Yes.
Yes. Yes, you are. And that's you know, the goddesses are learning from you right now, just being more, a little more responsible. So something like corona, nobody expected it, you know, and many things happen in your life that you were not expecting. And then it just happened. So can you take us back, Goddess Deepa, and tell us how was your life before that, some particular challenge of yours? Because your life is, as we were talking earlier, you know, you have challenges for your breakfast.
Breakfast. And I
and lunch and dinner.
I order them. I order them and I say, okay, bring it on. I'm gonna taste this one today. It's really crazy. But it keeps me going. I like to challenge my own limits. I like to continue to put myself to a new test every time. I don different hats. You yourself reading my resume. So, and each one in this body has been a journey of its own.
Right.
A journey of, because it's been a very, you know, it's broken the stereotypes. It wasn't done in the country.
Right.
It was a little difficult to fathom or to even conceive that an Indian woman who's a mother of two, in her mid-30s, after getting paralyzed and being in bed for 7 years, wants to get up and do biking. And she wants to do adventure mountain car rallies. So it was a little crazy idea, but I loved it. And listen, it happened.
Right.
All we need to do is take a bit of initiatives.
Yes.
Or eat a few challenges on your breakfast.
Right. Perfect. Now let's go to the recipe part. So which recipe are you sharing? Which challenge would you like to discuss? Because you have had a lot of, you know, you have your own menu. So which recipe are you discussing?
The biggest challenge that probably I would share today is defying the stereotype.
Mm-hmm.
And defying the stereotype. I know it's a very broader perspective, but that's what I have been calling myself, a mission on ability beyond disability, which clearly goes to show that I have defied the stereotypes the taboos around disability, the emotional taboos around disability, the social taboos around disability, and people not just who are suffering with the disability are limiting themselves in their minds, but somewhere caregivers around them are also limiting themselves. So
right.
It had to be, like I said, a collective growth to impact the mindsets of the society. So I think that challenge which I took upon myself 20 and a half years ago when I got paralyzed chest down. Of course, I had my own share of paralysis as a child when I had my first tumor. And they kind of came back. And nobody had given me any definition, any recipe, anything regarding how a woman would feel. Even just when you're feeling that you have a body which is so beautiful that you're crowned a queen. And months later, you are in chest below paralysis. The most beautiful body that you had has become now the biggest challenge of your life. You have to learn it all over again. And that challenge, well, I geared myself up to that challenge. And I not only took charge of myself physically, emotionally, mentally, also financially, because in a body like that, you need a lot of caregiving and you need a lot of support. And people look at you as a financial liability. Society looks at you as a dead body lying in the house. For a woman, a mother of two with two very young girls, a homemaker who had no professional degrees and had been married 10 years, that was quite a full stop in my life. And erasing that full stop and re-emerging from there, starting a new sentence, a new chapter, a new book of my life. I started a journey of defying the stereotype. I started a journey of erasing the limitations around a woman in a wheelchair with paralysis in the minds of the society. I had to take a lot of initiative. So yeah, it was tough, but now when I look back, I said nobody else has had a more happening life than mine. People said she'll not be able to step out. I have traveled the world.
Yeah.
People said she'll be a financial liability. I earn more than my husband. People said she will be disabled, weak, feeble. I am a strong athlete who has won Paralympic medal for my country. People
right.
said that she, she'll be sad. I think there is no one who's kicking life like me.
Truly, truly.
I'm like biking with John Abraham. I have done it. Dancing, Arun Khan and Hrithik Roshan. I have done it. Making the country laugh on Kapil Sharma laughter show. I have done it. Talk about winning money on the Kaun Banega Crorepati. I have done it.
Yes, been there, did that. What next? What next?
Been there, did that. Yeah. But it has been a journey of learning. It has
right.
been a journey of evolution. It's first discovering myself from within as to what can I now do with this one-third body. And being married, never worked. What all will I have to learn?
Right.
Being brought up, very closed contournment of army areas where everything is very beautifully provided for. Things move in a disciplinary manner.
Right.
We are punctual about time.
Right.
And it is a very set schedule and a routine, a very comfortable surrounding, being an army officer's daughter or a wife.
Right.
And then you step out of that cocoon to become a fighter in the public space. You want to question the system. You want licenses. You want your vehicles to be registered as invalid carriage. You want special permission to do Himalayan car rally as a chest below paralyzed person. You fight for system to pass the driving test for a person like me and also give me a high risk insurance.
Right.
That was again a major fight because
right.
people with disability are not allowed to do adventure.
Right.
There's a lot of tattoos and a lot of system that I had to find. Nobody was ready to make a customized motorcycle because the time that I wanted to be a biker, it was not common to import bikes like that.
Right.
So it had to be indigenously
customized.
And then I had to make a few records so that people heard me. Why would anybody hear me if I'm doing something in a corner of my home or my city? If I want to make an impact, the entire nation needs to know. So when the country will only know about it if you've done something extraordinary.
Right.
So I learn to become extraordinary from below ordinary. Because I'm often asked this question that, you look so normal, like normal people. That's like, who will define normal?
Normal. What is precisely, normal? Precisely.
Normal or am I normal? So the parameters of normal is by the statistics or by the percentage of people in a particular condition.
Right.
So I automatically become somebody who's not normal.
Right.
So it was not just a battle about my own inner struggle, inner journey, but it was also a struggle of letting people look at me in a normal manner and accept me.
Normal.
Yeah.
So, ma'am, I mean, you are sharing such beautiful things. And I'm still, one question is like tickling my head. And that is, you like today you are like beaming like a beauty queen. And then you get this affection thing, you know, not working. So nobody is ready for that. Like no one is ready for that. Like,
yes.
And the initial thoughts are not very positive, it's very usual to get into a victim mode, very easy to get in anger, in regret, in sadness, in chaos, in confusion. And in that space, you know, when a person is subjected to that, and it's not your fault, like it's not like you met with an ex or anything you did happen. It just happened.
You're very right. I think most of the time people don't get over their certain situations because they feel guilty about it.
Right.
The and only good was that I never felt guilty about it. It wasn't my choice. So I will not feel sad for something which was never my choice. You're very right. The acceptance of adversity is the biggest challenge. To get over a situation, to realize that you are in it. For me, I did not have much choice.
Okay.
For me, I did not have much choice because my husband was already at the war. The Kargil war in my country in 1999 was on. And we had very high casualty rate. Every morning we would hear the news hear about people who are, dying in the war. And I had a soldier husband who was at the war. So for me, I had two very small daughters. And I wasn't sure about whether the father will come back alive.
Right.
So I could not give up because all I was thinking about was staying alive so that I could be around my children because there wasn't much offered in the situation if the father was returning alive or not.
Right.
So I think I can give some credit to the situation in the country at that point of time.
Mm-hmm.
The motherhood became a very huge strength for me. A person's mind is not made overnight.
Right.
It is a continuous process. And a lot of it is credited to your parenting, how your parents have brought you up, what kind of a family you have been brought up in, what kind of values you have been introduced as a young child when you are most in a most impressionable age.
Right.
So I think kudos to my parents who have given me this ability to be positive in every situation. And I think they have led by example.
Right.
I've seen it. These are small habit forming right from your childhood.
Right.
You can't just have a tablet of courage and say, okay, today I'm courageous. Depends how seriously you have imbibed the education that you have been in. And my parents, my father, always insisted, even when we were children, he was more worried about, have we actually grasped what is written in the chapter? Have we taken the value out of it? Or we are just aiming at mugging it up and gaining marks? So I think these little habits from, I have seen my father finding solution for everything. I have seen my mother gearing up for everything. I have undergone 4 years of my childhood illness. And I worked hard for 2-3 years. Serious rehab. And that time my parents were there motivating me and giving me that habit of always fighting it out. So I think I had had a bit of a homework as a little girl.
Okay.
And since I have been brought up as a very positive thinking person, and I really, really, really thank my parents that they have made my mind into a solution finding mind rather than a cribbing mode mind. You know, it's people more than often harp about the problems. They right. stop focusing on the solutions.
Solutions, right. You
know? Yes. So my father and my mother has made my mind as I was growing up into a solution finding mind. He made us thinkers and not somebody just readers.
Right.
So I think that habit has always helped me. I remembered even as a child when I was lying in the bed for at least a couple of years, the doctors diagnosed me and then I was operated upon. And my father would often every day whisper in my ears, this too shall pass, this too shall pass. And I remember when I was going in for the surgery, he said one line to me and he says, Deepa, your name is Deepa and Deepa means a lamp. So please, please, just like your name, light a lamp rather than cursing the darkness of the sadness or you know, so just light a lamp. And when he said that, he definitely meant that light the lamp of learning about this. You know, we right. don't even want to learn about the situation. So I instead of thinking that I will never be able to walk again, I was more focused on how will I work with the 1/3 of the body that I'm left with.
Yeah.
So I think all this combined together gave me the strength, which was definitely propelled by my motherhood.
Beautiful. You know, I'm sure all the goddesses are getting the goosebumps like I am right now. It's so inspiring and amazing. Okay. Ma'am, here I want to ask you a question. Like you said about your childhood, about your parents, about some teaser that you got in your childhood as well. And you were, you know, emotionally at the right age, you were prepared into, and you were, first of all, right from your birth, you were named aptly. You are the light, you know, dispel the darkness. You are totally, you just lighten up everywhere you go. You just lighten up. So, ma'am, one gem, but you switch on. Oh, get away. So what is one gem you would like to offer to our goddesses? Maybe they didn't have that powerful childhood or parenting, you know, parents. Yeah. So what is one gem that they can, because they say, I don't have that courage, or I cannot buy that pill. So what is it that you can offer to them?
Be willing to learn.
Okay.
As simple as that. Just be willing to learn. Most of the time we resist a change.
Right.
We do not want to learn. We think we know it all. It always helps to learn more about a certain situation, about a particular, you know. So every disruption, every obstacle, every challenge is in a way a new situation.
Right. Right.
It's a new situation. So you have been taken out of your comfort zone and you have been placed in an absolutely new situation. So the only way you can battle it is by learning about that situation. So the more you learn, the more you prepare, the more confident you get about finding solutions. I have learned every day. People say, how do you multitask? How do you do so much? So I never gave up on learning. I learned to be a mother. I learned to be a homemaker. I learned to be an entrepreneur in this body to begin with. I learned the new body. I learned how to have a bath in this body, how to bath stool and urine in this body, how to manage the body, what clothes to wear in this body. And then once I had mastered that art, I ventured out. I learned to be an entrepreneur. I started a catering and a restaurant business. I interacted with the younger generation there and I enrolled myself in computer application program. I learned that. That opened the world out to me. I took the positive use of internet and I started exploring what more can be done. The biker in me came alive. I learned to be a biker. For that, I had to learn special skills. I had to learn about special permissions. I had to interact with new kind of people. And from there, I moved on to becoming the rally girl because people thought that I was going to die on the wheels of a wheelchair. So to break that stereotype, I chose the wheels of a car, of a bike. I made world records driving them across India, across Himalayas. But that also I had to learn.
Right.
And I didn't settle for comfort. I didn't settle for a life which was enough to live. If I had learned my body, that was okay. I mean, I could have just continued to live like that. Nobody was throwing me out of the house.
Yeah.
But I chose to stay out. Then I closed my business. I entered the world of sports at a very unconventional age, 36 as a swimmer, 40 as a javelin thrower. And then at 44, 45, I take up shot put seriously. And at the age of 48, because at the Asian Games and in the run-up of 2020, I will have to learn discus. So I learned discus. But by the time I made a medal in the Asian Games in 2018, my role was evolving in the public space. I was involved with a political party. I had to give up my government job. And beyond that, I took on the other roles. I'm a member in the Athlete Council, All India Sports Council, as appointed by the Government of India. You read out the role of being an ambassador between two countries.
Right.
So that's learning. If I had not accepted to learn, I would have probably not be ever chosen to give this opportunity. People have faith that if we are going to absorb people, so you have to create that faith. So learning gives that faith. People will look at you the way you look at yourself.
Right.
So people are no longer looking at me as a disabled person in chest pillow paralysis, just a woman who has never had a professional degree or anything. But now, because I learned and evolved, I have two doctorate degrees. I'm Dr. Deepa Malik.
Yes, Dr. Deepa Malik.
And I have mastered and got medals in more than 6 different events. That means 6 different set of learnings I must have undertaken.
Right.
I've been a brand ambassador for the Swachch Bharat campaign, and New Delhi Municipal Corporation has made me their brand ambassador. So I had to learn about that subject.
Right.
And now my current role as a president of the Paralympic Committee of India, I'm transiting from being an athlete into being an administrator. That itself is a kind of knowledge.
Right.
Its administrative process is totally different.
Different, right.
Than out there in the gym and exercising and throwing a shot put and coming back. This involves a lot of drafting, a lot of connecting with other organizations. So it's a different thing. So I think the biggest gem that I can offer from my life is that please continue and please be willing to learn and upgrade your knowledge. The more you grasp, the more you upgrade your knowledge, there are more chances of you exploring new worlds, new dimensions, new horizons. And the more you explore, you emerge as a winner and a more knowledgeable person, a more holistic person, a person who has more opportunity to give back.
Yeah.
Now today, if I was an athlete, I was just doing it for myself. I can say, of course, I was winning medal for my country. But as an administrator, now I can help so many more athletes. I can give back.
Right.
So I think that is what a woman have to learn, or my goddesses have to learn?
Beautiful, ma'am. I would like to hear a little bit about your NGO, you know, Wheeling Happiness, so that, you know, because that that's my personal project, Inclusive India. I dream of an India. That's my personal dream, you know, and I think, which is like mentally, physically, sexually, whatever choices you have or whatever condition you are, you should have an inclusion, you know.
See, as an Indian, I'm a very proud Indian of my heritage, of my country. My country has everything. Right. It has a Switzerland, it has a Hawaii, you know, it has the greenery. So it is a diversity. Even geographically, it is a very diverse country, offering us all the beauties of the nature. The only thing which differentiates us, and I have traveled internationally a lot representing my country, is cleanliness.
Right.
And accessibility. And I'm so fortunate that I have been, by virtue of my achievements, been involved in both these initiatives.
Right.
When we talk about inclusivity, we are also talking about gender equality.
Right.
So that's the space I really love working in. And my NGO is nothing but an extension of that. It is trying to create a new India, which is inclusive, not just infrastructurally, but also in their mindsets.
Yeah.
Accessibility, not just physical. Right. Accessibility is about your mind, accessibility about information technology. So we also work on a lot of accessibility, where we say accessibility without ramps.
Right.
The virtual ramps that you need to create in people's mindsets.
Mindset, yeah.
In their thought processes. So it was my daughter's idea, my elder daughter, Devika. She is a psychology student, and she often said that, Mom, it was because, you know, normally what is the chain? The chain is, I'm going to do this, and then I'm going to get this out of it, and then I will be happy. But my daughter said, Mom, you could do it all, because I think the first and foremost thing you focused on was being happy.
Happy.
Because you are happy. And a happy person is more sane, more energized, more motivated, more self-committed to do something, to right. achieve something. So let's start working on the happiness quotient of everything.
Right.
And happiness will come only when you have been able to identify your sources of. I was able to identify my sources of happiness. I loved outdoors. I loved adventure. I loved sport. I loved to be called a fit person in spite of being a paralyzed woman on a wheelchair. So I had certain passions, certain hobbies, which in turn would give me happiness. So we started focusing on creating sources of happiness. So we are calling our NGO Wheeling Happiness. We reach out to people with. We reach out to them with counseling, with certain assistive aids. We reach out with sessions for caregivers. And we are basically focusing in involving people in disability and their caregivers in a certain activity where they feel empowered. They regain and reclaim their confidence level in their bodies, which are otherwise called disabled. And this whole empowering process actually gives happiness.
Right.
So that's our NGO, which is all about. We are giving away wheelchairs. See, again, a person is given a wheelchair, which could be a patient wheelchair, but it cannot become its source of happiness, because if that particular person wants to play basketball or wants to play table tennis, or wants to go out and do wheelchair racing, then that person needs a specific wheelchair.
Right.
So we are nurturing them the way they feel happy. So providing them platforms of education, providing them support with the right kind of example. I'll give you small examples. There was a tailor who was born with no arms, so he learned tailoring with his feet. Okay. In a remote corner of a village. And through the internet, he reached out to me, and he said that he can no longer stitch, and the only livelihood he has is through stitching, because he has developed pain in his body.
Oh, okay.
So he had skill. Right. All we did was give him a pension of 3 months, allowed him to recover out of that pain. We realized that he was sitting on his haunches while excreting. He needed an English-styled commode, a WC. We altered his bathroom because he couldn't sit down because of the bad knees. We created a platform and a table matching the height where his legs don't get cramped in a way where the pain develops. And right. His spinal structure is good. So just by doing these little modifications and supporting him financially for 3 months, he's back on track.
Wow.
I've been able to put him back on track. There's another girl who was educated enough to teach in a primary school. And her school from her village house was about 800 meters.
Mm-hmm.
So she had to depend on somebody to pick her up and put her. So even in spite of the fact that she was self-confident, she was wanting to go out there and educate other children. She had empowered herself with a bit of a knowledge and education. But depending on somebody to pick her up who would go take her cursing, sometimes not take her to drop her there, was making her sad. What we did, we gave her a motorized wheelchair and she could just wheel herself, go and the school teach and come back. So we are just identifying that something which, like you said, the gem for the
the right gem.
So we identified, So we are identifying the right gem, which is their source of happiness. So beautiful. If you're rehabilitating, so another girl goes, ma'am, I see you travel. How do you travel without a bladder control? And imagine just by introducing to her to a thing called a diaper. So she had never used a diaper. She never understood a diaper. So all we did was teach her how to use a diaper and how to maintain the hygiene habits, how to take care of the skin when you wear the diaper. And now she goes out.
Travels everywhere. Yes.
Yes. Oh, so this is what we are doing. It might sound small, but it changes a lot.
It's like it could be a small room which is dark. You lit a candle, like your name, Deepa, and it's lit. And once it's lit.
And a lot of credit goes to my daughter. I'm grateful to her. So sometimes you can even learn from your own children. So it's my daughter's mother of me.
That's nice. You look young. You do look young.
Oh.
You don't look like a mom.
Let me pout.
Oh, please
my
do
daughter,
it.
She's there. The grown-up daughters. Let me pout. I think that's why I always say sports has been my anti-aging cream.
It is. Every time I meet you, you grow sitting, younger.
Yeah. Oh, I love you. I love you.
I love you too. You're always shining from inside. You know, it's your... Yeah. I mean every word that I say. So, ma'am, how
I
can
I... My soul smiles.
Right.
My soul smiles and my face shines.
It does. Yeah. That's the best beauty cream, you know.
Absolutely.
So, ma'am, how can our goddesses follow you? So, what are your social media handles so that they can follow you and get inspired the way I do all the time?
But I have a page on the Facebook. I have a personal profile. It's an open profile on the Facebook by my name. Fortunately, all my handles are now blue-ticked. They are verified accounts, so you don't have to follow a wrong account. Okay. Look for that blue tick. I've earned it. Twitter, you can find me. My handle is @DeepaAthlete. And Instagram, I'm learning. I am trying to be active on Instagram. So it's, I think, Deepa_Paralympian. So I'm there. I'm on Twitter. Okay. I'm on Insta. I'm on Facebook. And
lovely.
I have a website by deepamalik.com.
And with a single L. With a single L.
With a single L. DEEPAALIK.
Perfect.
And I have all my contact IDs on the website. And my NGO has a website, wheelinghappiness.org.in, and we also have a very active Facebook page for Wheeling Happiness.
Perfect. So our goddesses will follow you. Thank you so much for your time, your energy, your brightness. You know, I'm sure they will love this episode. And like, I just meant, you know, this was just a destined thing. You know, you wish for it. And I wanted someone so wonderful like you to be my first Indian guest. And I feel so honored. Namaste so much. Oh, thank you so
Namaste. Stay healthy. Stay safe. Be positive. Right. I think I very strongly believe in the power of intention.
Right.
What you think is what you become.
Yes.
So just think healthy and right. You'll remain healthy.
Yes. Thank you. Thank you so much, ma'am. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.